sharing about your heart. Your heart is being as a garden, and it's your first realm of responsibility that the Lord gives you. And so we're gonna continue along that lines this morning. And I want to read you a few verses of where the Lord first put this in about your heart being a garden. If you would, if you have a Bible, you want to look in Proverbs chapter 4. Proverbs chapter 4. Most of you are probably familiar with this portion of Scripture. The verse I'm after is 23. We're going to jump back to 20. And it reads like this: "My son, give attention to my words. Incline your ear to my sayings. Do not let them depart from your sight. Keep them in the midst of your heart, for they are life to those who find them, and health to all their whole body. Watch over your heart with all diligence, for from it flow the springs of life." I believe it's the Amplified. I'm not sure if this is right, but it's one of the other versions. In verse 23, it says like this. It says, "Above all the things that are to be kept, keep your heart." Now, you got to understand, the author of the book, every word that God speaks has purpose. I mean, and here's a better way. So he doesn't use words indiscriminately like we may do. So when he says this, he says, above all the things. Now watch this, he means this. Above everything that needs to be kept, and you're to pay attention to, and you're supposed to protect. Above everything else, he tells you, keep your heart. And he tells you, because it's out of your heart will flow the streams or the rivers of life. Okay? Now, so everything is determined by your heart. Everything comes from out of your heart. Now, I want to put this in there right now while it's still on my mind. In that verse, in verse 23, listen what it says. "Watch over your heart with all diligence, for from it flow the springs of life." See the word flow in there? If you have the same, you probably don't have the same version. Anyway, the word flow is in italics. And when you find that in the Bible, it means that word is not in the scripture, but it's added by the translator to give sense to the verse. Does that make sense? It's not in the original writings, but it's been added in order to give you a sense of what the verse is saying. So if we leave it out, here's what it says. Watch. It would read like this: "For from it are the springs of life." For from it are the springs of life. Well, I discovered something really interesting a few years ago about this verse. The word spring means more than the obvious, a spring of water, but it also means boundaries. It means boundaries, and it means the extremity. It means the very farthest reaching boundary. In other words, like this: in a city, you may have property and you can put a wall around it, and those become your boundaries. Others may do the same thing. Businesses may do it. But as we don't do it now, but in Bible times, there were walls that surround the whole city. Jerusalem was surrounded by a wall. So what he's saying here, the most extreme, the farthest out borders are what he's talking about. So he's saying, let me read it like that then. Listen to what it says. "For from it are the boundaries of life." For from it are in it, in your heart, the boundaries of your life are determined. the very boundaries of your life are determined in your heart. It's in your heart where you believe God. If you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. But listen, the very extension of borders in your life are determined by what you decide upon in your heart. You know that? Listen, vision is a matter of the heart, not of your mind. When you receive vision from God or purpose from God or whatever, and you take that in and you receive it, and you give it attention like it says, and you meditate upon that, you literally create borders. You extend the borders of your own life. Let me give you an example. If you get saved and God puts in your heart and you know that you've been called to be an evangelist, let's say, and you embrace that reality and you take it in, you guard that, you keep it, you meditate on it over time. In time, the borders of your life will be extended and you'll begin to walk in realms that you never walked in before. Does that make sense? Okay, so I want you to get this. This is the point, is how vastly or how greatly important the matter of keeping your heart is. Listen, guys, because if we don't do that, nothing else is going to work. Listen, just by meeting people all the time and talking to people, most of the time I'm amazed at how many times Christians have no... They give no attention to their own heart. And guess what happens? I mean, it causes your whole life to be out of whack. And I'm going to show you in a minute what that means. And we're going to see that, okay? Now, I want you to go back with me to Genesis 1, 2, and 3 quickly. I just want to point out a few things that are there, and then we'll come back to this verse. In Genesis 1, when God created man, you'll find that in verse 28. And he says, he created man in his own image and in his own likeness. And he blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, and subdue it, and rule over. So watch this. Here's what in the very beginning, God gave a mandate to all of mankind. This is still good. This has not been rescinded. This mandate that was given by God in Genesis 1 is still in effect. And he tells you and I, he's created us to rule. Not necessarily over one another, but he has created you and I to rule. He has. And he says to us, he wants us to become fruitful and multiply. Now there's the obvious natural element to that, but there's the spiritual element. As a believer, you're God's intention for your life is you begin fruitful. You begin to grow fruits of the Spirit, fruits in different areas. Okay? Do you realize you can work and never produce fruit? You know what I'm saying? So we're created to produce fruit. The spirit that's within you, this new spirit that you receive from God, is works and will produce fruit through you, okay? And multiply. What's he mean by multiply? Well, when you share the gospel with people, that's one way, and they get born again, you've multiplied. Does that make sense? Also, when you pour yourself into someone else, as a mentor, as a discipler, whatever term you want, a mother or father in the faith, as you pour yourself into one another, you multiply. Huh? Just like you should do with your own children, you are multiplying yourself in them. They're an expression of you in one way. Okay? Now, watch this. So, we're created to rule, to be fruitful, and to multiply. And then in verse 2:15, here's what it says. Then the God took the man, he put him into the garden to cultivate and keep it. Now, I didn't read it to you, but it's over in, let me back up to verse 8. The Lord God planted a garden toward the east in Eden, and there he placed the man whom he had formed. Now watch, God had just created everything. He created the heavens and the earth, and it said, and then he planted a garden. You realize that gardens don't happen naturally? They don't. The gardens have to be planted. Behind the garden is an intelligence. There's intention and there's purpose if there's a garden. You don't grow gardens by accident. Shake your head, do something, so I know you're here. You've never come up on a flourishing garden that grew all by itself. So to have a garden, you have to be intentional. There's got to be purpose. There's got to be vision for what it is that you're after, okay? All right, now watch this. Back to the other verse. That was verse 8, now go to verse 15 again. Here's what we launch from. Then the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to do two things. In the Garden of Eden, I want you to get this picture. Here's a new creation. Never been a heaven and earth before that we know anyway. Brand spanking new. He creates the man. He creates the man and then he plants a garden. Then he places the man that he created and put him in the garden. And he gave him two responsibilities, to cultivate and keep it. To cultivate it and to keep it. And I want you to see this morning, and I want to reiterate from what I've said in the past, but you need to see this, that garden represents a realm of responsibility that's been given to you. It's the place of your assignment. Now, if you'll read Genesis chapter 2 and 3, you'll find out that the garden was the place where man walked with God. That's where he walked with him at, was in the garden. Not anywhere else, but in the garden. It was in the garden where man has fellowship with God. That's the place where you hear the voice of God. Huh? Now, all this is pointing to a higher spiritual reality than just the fact of a natural garden. So listen, guys, God gives us gardens to steward or to manage and watch over. Now here's what I want you got to see is that your first, in priorities, your very first realm of responsibility is your own heart. Now watch, now listen, if we neglect that and try to do other things, it is not going to work. It may look good for a little while, but it won't work, it won't last, it won't produce what you're after. Why? Because this is the way the thing works. In the beginning, God says, he creates mankind, I want you to subdue and rule over the whole earth. Right? That's what he told him. I want you to rule over the whole earth, but then he put him in the garden. He didn't just turn him loose in the whole world. He placed him in a defined area. And he says, now here, in this place, I want you to cultivate and keep this. Here's God's intention. This is the divine design behind it, is if Adam and Eve can fulfill what God had told them to do, if they multiply, if they become fruitful, and they cultivate and keep this, the borders will be extended. Their own family, their children will grow, and they will extend the borders. And it will continue like that until the whole world has been subdued and ruled over. You see that? In other words, this thing was meant to be increase and expansion in concentric circles. In other words, you start here, bigger, bigger, bigger expansion. until the whole earth has been brought under the government of God. God wanted to extend his rulership and his presence, his person into the world. And this is how he chose to do it. So, you know, every one of us, God's put us in different realms of responsibility. Your family is one of those, right? If you have a wife, children, husband, whatever, that's a garden that you've been given responsibility for. And you know that if when you have responsibility, you also have authority. Yes. Too many times we want authority without the responsibility. It doesn't work. But God gives us different realms of responsibility. Your workplace. Now you may see, this is why we need to see it this way, because too many times we're just there. Too many times guys just, or women, just go to work. And just, well, I'll be glad when this is over. Or whatever your thought system is. But listen, you've been given, listen to me, you've been given a realm of responsibility. God intends for you to cultivate and keep that area. So your family, your workplace, and you got ministry, that's another circle that goes out and goes out. You get the idea? That, listen, but what determines whether this happens for me? Whoop, go back to your first one. If this doesn't happen, it'll only be you without God trying to make it bigger. See, God works according to purpose and design, and he's not going to do it a different way. So listen, if I can't be fruitful and multiply and subdue this, what makes me think I can do anything more than that? Does that make sense to you? So watch this, guys. Your first garden is right here. Right here. You're to cultivate and you're to keep. And I'm going to give you some definitions of those two words, cultivate and keep. All right, cultivate. Interesting. The word means some of what you would recognize, to work. It means to till. You know, if you plow, you till. It means to serve. But here's the one that I was amazed at, and it's actually this word for cultivate also actually means worship. Isn't that interesting? Think about that. I mean, it literally is, and not just in the Hebrew language. I went to the English dictionary, and it's there too. So the word cultivate also can mean worship. So just keep that in mind. One of the ways you cultivate, well, what do you, watch this. What do you think you're going to cultivate in your garden? First and foremost is a relationship to him. That's where he meets you, right? This is where you walk with him. This is where you receive your instructions. This is where you have fellowship with him, right? So how do you cultivate that? Through worship. You cultivate a relationship with the Creator. Through worship. Now, we talked last week, I'll put this in here. The word Judah, one of Jacob's sons, the word Judah means praise. And there's a verse in Hosea 10:11. It says, Judah plows. Judah plows. What's it mean? Well, put praise in there instead of Judah. Praise plows. Listen, guys, one of the best ways that I know keep your heart from getting hard. You know, when we neglect the heart, like the ground, it goes back to its original state where it's fallow, it's hard. One of the best ways that I know of to get that stony ground or that hard dirt back up is through praise and worship. I don't mean a one-time event. Coming back to a relationship with him so that there's authentic praise and worship, right? And listen, why did I say it? Because watch, guys, every other responsibility that you have should come out of your intimacy with God. All ministry, if you're involved in ministry, listen, all ministry should flow out of fellowship and intimacy with God. Amen. If not, then it's probably just you doing it. We can do a lot of good things that are not a God thing. You realize that, don't you? Good and God are not synonymous. I'm sorry. And too many times in the church we think they are. Well, that's a good. It's religious. It's this. It's helping. He says, yeah, you can do all that. He said, many will come to me in that day and say, didn't we do miracles in your name? Didn't we do all these things to cast out demons? He said, wait, I'm sorry, I don't know you. Yeah. Okay, so every good thing is not necessarily a God thing. You need to keep that in mind. Seriously, listen, guys. You were created for partnership. You were created for partnership with God. You're not just a servant. You are, but you're a son and you're a daughter. You've been called into partnership with the Almighty. Sons and daughters, the family business of ruling the earth. Huh? And how does that happen? It comes out of intimacy. How will I know what to do? You got to spend time with the one who does know. Huh? It's not hard. It's just not as easy as it might think sometimes. But then again, it is easy. We make it hard. I shouldn't say that. We do. We make it hard. Does any of this make sense to you? Listen, guys, it's out of that walking in your garden, spending time with the one who created, planted it, listening to him, tilling the ground through worship and praise. And what are the seeds that you're going to plant here? Jesus gave the parable of the sower. He said, I'm the one, the Son of Man, sows the seed. And he talks about that seed going into the heart, right? Remember that? The seeds go into the heart. What are those seeds? What are they? Parable of the sower. This is not a trick question. Words, right? Wow. The word of the kingdom. Any word of the kingdom is like seeds, right? Words are containers of thoughts. In order for me to give you my thoughts, I give you a word which contains my thought, right? So the parable of the sower, what's the point of the parable of the sower? There's four different soils that Jesus is referring to. Remember that? What he meant by the ones by the wayside at that time in that culture, there wasn't roads per se in outlying areas. You had to walk through each other's properties because there wasn't any road. You got out of your field, you want to go over there, you got to go through somebody else's field. So those places where you walked from place to place is that place where he said where seed was thrown by the wayside. It means it wasn't in the garden, it was in the places where you walk. Well, think about it. What happens to those places where you walk all the time? Right? He doesn't even go in. He said, it just lies there. And so Satan comes and snatches it away before it can do anything. Remember? And then he talked about soil that falls on ground that's rocky and doesn't have any depth to it. It can't get water. And so what happens? It just barely gets in the ground. It springs up right away because it can't go deep. It's the only place it can go is up. But what happens to it? Barely in the ground. As soon as the sun comes up, it's too much. And it dies. He said, that's like the person who receives the word with joy. They're overjoyed at what they've heard. But when trouble and different things, persecution comes for the word, they fall away. But the one that I want you to see, he said, there are other ones that were, forget about you guys up here, because I'll let you back up. Sorry, I didn't mean to neglect you. Watch this. So the soil of thorns and weeds. Wow, this is so big and so huge. And if you can get nothing else this morning, this will help as much as anything will to understand what I'm trying to say to you. So Jesus, in fact, if you have a Bible, go to Luke chapter 8 and we'll look at it from there. You realize the parable of the sower is in three of the Gospels, three of the four. And anytime God repeats himself, the value of what he said rises. Not the value, but the importance of what he says rises. If you say it more, well, that's like you do. When you say it more than once, you probably really mean it. That's not a good whatever, is it? Never mind. Go to Luke 8. Luke 8. Obviously, I don't know. Okay, let's look at this. Jesus is giving, explaining the parable of the sower. Go to verse 14. He's going to explain what it looks like when seed falls among weeds, thorns, thistles. And the seed which fell among the thorns, these are the ones who have heard, they heard the word, and as they go on their way, they are choked with what? What's your say? Worries and riches, pleasures of this life. Now watch this, the Mark 4, the same passage, adds to it the desire for other things. Now watch this. Riches, pleasures, and other things are nothing evil. There's nothing evil about, nothing wrong about those things. But he says, these are the things that if they're allowed to grow in your heart, they will choke out the life out of the seeds that came from him. The kingdom always comes to you in seed form. You realize that, don't you? We would like to have it come to us as fruit. Watch this. The kingdom always comes to you in seed form. It's what you do with it that will determine whether it becomes fruit in your life. Huh? You get it? See, it's not enough just to hear the word. You can hear the word like those other guys, go away rejoicing, but that doesn't mean you got it yet. You just received some seed. It's what you do with the seed that will determine the harvest. Okay? So, now watch this. So he's talking about thorns. Now, where did thorns come from? Do you know? Let me tell you. In chapter 3, don't go there, but listen. Chapter 3 of Genesis, after Adam and Eve had sinned and God brought them into accountability for what had happened, we find out where thorns, thistles, weeds came from. Watch this. He's talking to Adam, verse 17. Then to Adam he said, because you've listened to the voice of your wife and have eaten from the tree about which I command you, saying you should not eat from it, cursed is the ground because of you. In toil, not work, but in toil you should eat of it all the days of your life. Now watch this. Both thorns and thistles shall grow for you. Thorns and thistles shall grow for you. Listen, it's thorns and thistles. Weeds are a result of the fall. The curse on the earth is where you get weeds. They serve no purpose. Weeds serve no legitimate purpose. They're a result of the fall. Jesus equates the things we just read about with weeds. Does he mean he doesn't want us to have any pleasure in life? No. Does it mean he doesn't want us to have any wealth? No. Or any other thing? No. You know what he doesn't want? It's for them things to fill your heart. Let me ask you like this, what do you have to do to grow weeds? Absolutely nothing. You can grow the best weeds around. You can just give them a place to grow. They even grow sometimes where they don't have a place. So some of you know they grow up between the concrete and anywhere else they can. That's the nature of a weed. Now watch, and weeds always multiply, don't they? Watch this. This is all a result of the curse on the earth. When weeds grow, they multiply and they'll push out and choke out the life and the sustenance in the soil so that the true seeds can't receive it. Now watch this. So think about it. He's talking about your heart. If you allow, listen, if you don't protect your heart, you don't keep it, you don't cultivate it, there's no question what's going to grow there. Listen real carefully. There's not a question about what will grow in your heart if you don't cultivate and keep it. Weeds will grow. Weeds will grow. Now watch what will happen, and then you'll hear the word. And it'll fall on ground, but it'll never bring any fruit to maturity. Why? Because the weeds that you've allowed in your garden will choke the life out of it. You won't be able to bring forth. Listen to me, guys. Most of the problems that most of the people that I know today are a result of just this, not keeping their own heart. And they don't know what's wrong. They can't figure out what's wrong in their marriage, in their home life. I can tell you what it is. You want to go find out where? Go back here. Your first garden is not being taken care of. You're trying to fix this when you need to fix this. Why? If you fix this, you won't have to worry about that. You get it? If I take care of this and I got the right heart to be a husband and a father, I don't have to work so hard on the other. Huh? Does that make sense? And on and on and on and on it goes, right? Okay. All right. Hang on. All right. Okay, so that was cultivate. To keep means this. Now listen to this. I mean, it's the obvious to protect something, right? To guard it and protect it. That's the obvious. But it means more than that. When you keep something, it means to pay close attention to give care to watch over something and to keep an eye on it. So watch, it's not enough just to protect your garden from the enemy. That's obvious, right? You got to protect and you don't want serpents in your garden, right? You see what happened to the first man? So we obviously want to keep the critters out, because critters will eat your fruit. They'll let you grow, but then they'll eat it for you. Okay? So he says here, he's saying, you need to keep an eye on it. Take care of it. In other words, your own heart, you need to watch it. Pay attention. What's going on there? I'm afraid most people don't have a clue. They never get quiet enough to hear and see what's going on in their own heart. And that's sad. Listen, I truly believe this. I may be wrong. I can't prove it. But I believe the greatest, I don't know if you use weapon, greatest thing that the enemy uses on real believers to neutralize them is not sin, but it's busyness and distraction. Listen, distract you with all kinds of good things so that you neglect the one thing Jesus said that's needful. Remember that? Martha and Mary? Yeah, thank you for shaking your head. There's one. He's here. It's just nice to know you're alive, man. You do something. You scare me. It's like, I don't know if they're here or not. The light's on, but nobody's here. What was I saying?
Martha and Mary.
Martha and Mary. Remember that? See you guys. Bye. I had to. Remember they were Lazarus' sisters. Remember that? And Jesus, that was his favorite place on earth. You know that, don't you? Do you know, I found this out, that Jesus never spent the night ever in Jerusalem. Never. Not according to Scripture. Let me say it. You know where he stayed every chance he got? Bethany. In the house, in the home of Mary and Martha in Lazarus. Every chance he could. You think about it. There's a reason. Now you remember this? Jesus is coming to town. Martha hears about it. He's coming to their house. So she's busy fixing a big dinner and stuff. Well, Jesus gets there. Obviously, I'm assuming he sat down. I don't know that. It doesn't say. But he began to share the words with them. Mary is seated at his feet, taking it all in. Martha's busy trying to get things ready. I love what Bill Johnson said. He says, Martha was busy fixing a meal that Jesus didn't order. Now, does that mean it's wrong to be to serve? No, that's not the issue. It's not pitting one against the other. But when Jesus is in the room and he's speaking, you need to sit down. Listen, guys, what he has to say to you is far more important than what you have to say to him. And listen, when he's speaking, you need to put your ears up and sit down. There's nothing wrong with serving, but there's a time for both, right? You'll miss out on the thing. But I really believe distraction is probably the number one thing the enemy has. Now, it's, and you know what? It's not bad things. If you're a believer and you're really a believer and you're walking with God, it's usually not sin that gets you, per se. It's other things. They're vying for first place in your heart. All these other things, good things, right things, and we never give attention to the heart. Does that make sense? This is huge, guys. I'm telling you, I know this. I don't know anything. If you can get this, it's going to change the whole trajectory of your life from here. I'm serious. Because if not, you're always going to try to figure out what's wrong. I can tell you, I'm trying to tell you right now, go back to your garden and get that where it should be. And the rest will take care of itself. It will. Okay. All right. Oh, the word keep, where he says cultivate and keep, the word keep also means, it's the word for watchman. Watch this. It's the word for watchman. So watch this. The word cultivate is the word for worship. Keep is the word for watchman. That explains or describes your responsibilities. Huh? How do you keep your garden? You worship and you watch. To watch means you're attentive. You're paying attention. And you're worshiping. And out of, watch, here's what I want you to see. It's out of there. As you move into intimacy with God, that's where you get your assignments. That's where you hear his voice. Right? Huh? Instead of doing everything else. Does that mean you don't do anything yet? No. It's a matter of priority. Huh? See, too much time in the church, we put the Great Commission above the First Commandment. He didn't intend for that. The First Commandment, guys, is still the First Commandment. I'm sorry. Now, it doesn't negate the other. That's not the issue. But listen, the Great Commission would be a lot easier if we keep the First Commandment. Yeah. Huh? Does that make sense? Get it? Yeah. It will be, really. This is what I'm hoping you'll begin to see, is that if we get the first things right, the first things, most of the rest will take care of itself. Okay. All right. We won't beat this dog to death. We'll see if we can go a little farther. Oh, you'll like this. Listen to this one. This is so good. A verse most all of you will recognize, Proverbs 23:7. As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Now watch this. The word think in Hebrew, take a wild guess what this means. It means a couple of things. It means to open. It means to split. But here's the best one. It means to act as a gatekeeper. Wow. To act as a gatekeeper. So if we put that in and listen how it reads then. As a man acts as a gatekeeper over his own heart, so is he. Now here's what he's saying. Whatever you get to decide what comes in and out of your heart, and whatever you allow to come in and out will be what you'll become. You become what you behold. Whatever I focus on, I empower. Listen, this is why so many are always in anxiety and depression because they're focusing on the problem. Well, you only empower it. You only make it huge by looking at it. Huh? I'm telling you. You need to shift your focus upon the one who can fix it. And stay there. That problem begins to shrink. It's not as big as you think. It's only big in your heart and your mind because you've paid so much attention to it. It is. It explodes inside of you. And you're full, watch this, if you're full of worry, fear, anxiety, I can tell you why you've been thinking about stuff that creates that. Listen, all of your emotions follow your thoughts. You feel like what you've been thinking about. Listen, it's true. It's so important, guys. You've got to guard your heart, what you allow in. You can't just let anything coming and going run around in your heart. You can, But then you're going to have all kinds of trouble. Huh? Now watch this. I want to show you this. All right, I got a couple things, but let's go. Go to Philippians chapter 4 if you got a Bible. Let me show you this. I don't know if you realize it or not. I've said this before. Worship is an act of war, too. And look, you keep your heart, you're engaged in warfare by keeping your own heart. I'm going to show you. Watch this. It's huge. Who is the enemy? He's the God of, watch this, he's the God of this world. And he wants to keep all your attention upon this world. And if he can do that, he's got you. He keeps you distracted by the cares and affairs of life. He's won. He will neutralize you so fast and make your head spin. All he's got to do is get you worried about everything else but the one thing that matters. You get the one thing that matters, most of the other stuff will take care of itself. It really will, won't it? It's true, isn't it? All right, Philippians chapter 4. I want you to look at this in a warfare context. You might not have thought of it like this before, but watch it now. Philippians 4, verse 4. Paul speaking. While he's in prison, and those prisons weren't like our prisons. They don't even compare. They were bad. You were thrown in the middle darkness to whenever they decide to come in and do something. In darkness, with your own feces, the whole nine yards. They didn't do nothing to take care of if you were there. He's in that place when he writes this. Here's what he says, verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. And I will say, rejoice. Let your forbearing spirit be known to all men. The Lord is near. Now watch what he says. Be anxious for nothing. Now, why does he say that? Because you have control over it. Listen, you are not a victim of your own thoughts. You become anxious because you're thinking thoughts that produce anxiety. You don't have to. Be anxious or nothing. Watch this. You keep your place. Let me read you this. What Jesus himself said in John 14. This is an act of war. Watch this. Jesus says to them, he's about ready to go back to the Father. He says, peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. Not as the world gives do I give you. Let not your heart be troubled, nor let it be afraid. He would not say that if you couldn't do that. He said, don't allow it. It's out here wanting to come in. Don't allow it in. He said, in fact, receive my peace. Let my peace protect your heart. Don't give in to anxiety and all the other stuff. Does that make sense? Now, Philippians 4. Verse 6, be anxious for nothing, but, he tells you, don't do that, but do this. In everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, that's a component that's needed, thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. Now watch this. And the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, shall what? Guard your heart. Now watch this. He doesn't use the words indiscriminately. He uses a word that was meant for an army or a battalion of an army to surround a place and protect it or whatever. But the word is to garrison. He says, if you'll do what he said, his peace will guard and protect your heart. You don't have to be there. You don't have to live there. You don't have to live in anxiety, worry, fear, doubt, unbelief. You don't have to. If you don't hear anything else today, you get to choose. It's your choice. Don't let your own thoughts rule you. People think, I can't help it. Yes, you can. It may take a little work at first, but you can. Trust me, I know what it's like to have it the other way. It's much nicer over here. Real, a whole lot nicer. It really is. And you can. You don't have to have that stuff in your garden. All right, now watch this. And so let the and the peace of God which surpasses all comprehension shall guard your hearts and minds. See that? Hearts and minds. Both of them. You think in two places. You know that, don't you? You think with your heart and you think with your mind. Did you know that? But you have to believe not with your mind. You got to believe with your heart. This is why a lot of people who believe all the right stuff, but they're not saved, because they have a belief in their mind, but they haven't believed their belief with their heart. Huge difference. Huge difference. Huge difference. Then he says, finally, brethren, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute, if there's any excellent, if there's anything worthy of praise, watch what he says, let your mind dwell on these things. You've got a choice. You've got a choice. Listen, guys, every day you get to determine the atmosphere of your own heart. You do. You get to determine the atmosphere that you live in. Now, have you ever walked into somebody's atmosphere? You can tell it's something different, good and bad. You ever walk in when somebody's depressed and stuff? Whoa. But have you ever walked in, somebody's got something going on, you may not have to be able to explain it. Wow, there's something nice and good here. Yeah, because you get to create the atmosphere that surrounds you. You get it? You do. You really do. You can. Scriptures are clear all through Proverbs. All through Proverbs. Amazing. Okay. Probably about enough. Still didn't get anywhere. Let me see. Hang on a minute. Before you can see. Okay. I was going to say one more thing, but you know that's not true. Proverbs 24, and I will try. This is, you want a beautiful picture of what your heart looks like when it's neglected? I'll show you. It's right here. Wait till you see this. Proverbs 24, verses 30 through 34. Proverbs 24, 30-34. He said, I passed by the field of the sluggard. What's a sluggard? A lazy person. And by the vineyard of a man lacking sense. You know what the word sense really is? It's the word for heart. It's the actual word for heart. I didn't know this until I was researching. And by the vineyard of a man lacking heart. And behold, it was completely overgrown with what? Thistles. Its surface was covered with nettles, weeds. Okay, now what? That's one thing, but look what else. And its stone wall was broken down. The very thing that was meant to give it protection is broken down. And when I saw it, he said, I reflected on it. I looked and I received instruction. Here's what he deduced. Is that right, deduced? Is that right? Nobody caught it anyway. A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest, then your poverty will come as a robber, and your want, or your whatever, like an armed man. Huh? But do you see that? When you neglect your own heart, here's what you'll get. It'll get covered up with weeds, and your wall of protection will be broken down. Listen, and the critters are overrun. Now, if you're in that place, it seems like impossibilities come out of it, but that's a lie too. Listen, the enemy comes with true, half-truths and bits of truth. And let me end with this. This book, listen guys, there's more to it than just doing a daily devotion. And okay, I read my thing for the day, that's nice. I'm not sure how much good it'll do you. Good place to start, but listen, guys, we need to take this thing seriously. The Word of God, listen, if you don't have your heart full of the Word of God, you have nothing in you to challenge the lies when they come, or the other junk, whatever it is. Huh? If I don't have it, the word is like a light. And if I don't have my heart full of it, listen, you'll entertain all kinds of things. You don't won't even know it. You'll know it when you can't get out. You'll know it when you're depressed, but you won't know how you got there. Teaching her that? Genetics. All right, let me. No, not one more. Look, the one thing that matters, that I see matters more than anything, listen, if I had this life to do over in my spiritual life, if I was back at the beginning, I would do things completely different than I have done. And I want to give you something just from a perspective of having walked in this thing a long time that I would definitely do different. And it's just what I've been telling you. I would give this my full attention. Listen, I would grow in this heart the knowledge of God, who God really is. That's so huge. The knowledge of who He is, what He's done, what He will do, His promises, all of those things. I would want my heart full of the knowledge of God. Not just facts, but experiential, personal knowledge, revelation knowledge of who God is. Because listen, guys, when that comes, it'll deal with everything. Listen, I want to listen to this. Here's the deception that too many of us are in, is that we have a belief system with our mind, and we say, well, I believe God is love. I believe God is good. He's all these things. Listen, that's a belief. And if you'll get quiet and look at your own heart, you're going to find you may not believe your beliefs. Huge difference. You can hold to the right belief but not believe any of them. You could say God is love, but down in your heart you don't believe that He loves you. You could believe, let me just share with you what's in my own life. Scripturally, the right beliefs about God and about who He is. But I knew I was still having lots of trouble. Can't figure out why. What in the world is wrong? And one of the main things that I've discovered is this. I had beliefs, but I didn't believe most of them. Now watch this. I had images. I didn't even realize it. Had an image of God that was a false image. That He was distant and aloof, uninterested and uninvolved. Was silent most of the time and was uninterested. This is kind of the image of would be an image like this. Like He was just tolerating me mostly. Every now and then I did really good. But listen, now I could have told you the right beliefs of what who God is. But the problem is I couldn't believe them with my heart. It's not enough just to add new information. You've got to get rid of the old stuff that's in there. Let me challenge you to something. Let me just do that. You get an opportunity to get quiet by yourself when you've got a little bit of time. Don't take a lot of time. And just be honest and be willing to look at your own heart. I think you'll be amazed. Just get quiet and look at what roams around in your own heart and mind. Think you might be, yeah. Just give it some time and see what you really do think, what you really do believe. Most of us, listen, we've learned the language. We've learned the language of identity. I'm this and I'm that and that, but we don't believe any of it. It's a problem. Because the heart's not being changed. You just got some add-ons in your mind. Does this make sense to y'all? Listen, guys, do yourself a favor. Why keep going? If that's you, if you're having whatever, you know something, this is not working out so well. You've done all you know to do, kind of thing. Maybe some of you are doing fine. I don't know. I shouldn't say it like that. But if that's not the case, I would start right here. Just get along. I'm telling you, we're a unique creature. We can watch ourselves think. You know that, don't you? God created us so we can watch ourselves think. You don't have to go to the movies. But you really, you can watch what you're thinking about, and it's amazing. I couldn't believe what was running around, been running around in my mind. Freely running around, didn't even know it. I knew I had trouble, I knew the outcome of having it, but I didn't know what it was. So I'm going to end with that. And how about this? How about if I pray? Let's pray this. That God would give you a spirit of wisdom and of revelation. A revelation in the knowledge of Him. And He revealed your own heart to you. Would you all want that? Okay, would you just receive it? I'm going to pray that for you. Okay? All right. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your goodness, that you really are good. And you want the very best for us. And I thank you for that. Father, you know that we can't even know our own heart without your help. We want to know you, but we want to know our own heart too, Lord. So I pray, Father, for every receptive heart right now that's in this place, Lord, that they're receptive to you, that God, that you would grant them, that you would give them, Father, the spirit of wisdom and revelation, let it come upon them. Let revelation come to their heart, even in the night seasons while they dream. I just ask you, Lord, come upon them with revelation. You know what everyone needs to see. I just ask you to do that in Jesus' name. Amen.